Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the session 1, reminders and homework review, Jesus revises and provides reminders from the previous Understanding My Unloving Self 2-day session and reviews the homework of the participants. Recorded on the 24th of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
A lot of pensive faces in the audience today. What's that going? What's going on there? You're worried about this 2 days. Yeah. Well, before we get on this 2 days, we want to review the last 2 days and do some of your homework. We won't be spending much time doing the review. So this session is called Review and Homework. We will be doing a very short review because I want to spend a bit more time on your homework, if that's all right with you. And we've only got 40 minutes for this session, so we'll just be doing a brief review of the three main topics that we discussed in the last 2 days when we're talking about understanding our unloving self, which was the theme of the previous 2 days. And then we'd like to sort of have a look at some of your homework. Unfortunately, of course, that is going to be a fairly brief as well, but you can see from the homework that you were given that it's probably going to take you 6 months at least to sort out some of those things from an emotional perspective. But at least we need to discuss it and identify a fair bit of those things regarding our homework. All right, so first session that we had on the first day was about the creation of our pain. And what did we learn in the creation of our pain? If we go across Di on this side, and Glenda on this side.
The majority of my pain is caused by the result of my own sin.
Yes, and that's particularly the pain that's going to be the hardest to release. So the majority caused by my sin. Remembering the word sin is always everything that I've decided to do and say and think and feel out of harmony with love. So my sin, and my sin in three primary areas, in my relationship with God, my relationship with self, and my relationship with others. But it does include things like other things as well, like things like relationship with the environment and so forth. Because you can actually sin from God's perspective in the way you treat the environment and those kind of things. So of course, there are many other things that are less important than those particular things. Yeah. Okay, so my sin and Linda?
My parents' sin.
So parents' sin. And of course, my parents' sin is in those same areas, isn't it? Pretty much. Including the others that are unlisted and third.
And others.
Yeah, so society.
Society and spirits.
Society, yeah. So remember, society includes the spirits that surround us as well. You know, even though you can't see them, you feel them. Pretty much every single moment of your life, you will feel them. So they are and do have quite a lot of influence upon your behaviour and your tendency towards sin. So that's the main. They are the main sources of the creation of my pain. But what are the main causes? The main causes are. If we come to assess down the front and then up the back, maybe. Yep.
My false beliefs.
So false beliefs. Beliefs and the second thing, if we go right up the back,
I was going to say false beliefs.
You were too. Yep. Okay. So if we go to Joy on this side.
Thank you. False definitions of love.
Yes, and remember they are all
evil.
Yeah, they're emotions, aren't they?
They're emotions.
They are emotions. So you could let's call them the evil, the opposite of love. And these are all emotions, remember. They're not just intellectual thoughts, although they do trigger your intellectual thoughts. But they are emotions. They are feelings you have. And it's the feelings that you have that drive you to sin. Right? They create the thoughts. They create your words. They create your desires and passions a lot of the times, these underlying emotional feelings. Okay. Now, of course, we could also say, couldn't we, that the main reason, the main causes of sin are related to the use of our will, aren't they? And in fact, that is the case. The use of our will out of harmony with God's laws is what causes sin, really. But these are the areas in which we have used our will out of harmony with God's laws. Now, it doesn't mean necessarily that we have, because other people have too, haven't they? And that's imposed their belief systems upon us. But we've got to remember always that the hardest and most difficult pain you're going to release is going to be surrounding where you have a tendency to sin, not surrounding others' sin against you, because you find that will be a little easier to address. And when I say a little easier, quite often it's substantially easier. You can recognize it more easily often and also deal with it more easily. Forgiveness is definitely easier than repentance. Eva?
Thanks. Do false beliefs inherently have fear in them, or do they create fear?
No, it's an interesting relationship with false beliefs, isn't it? But they inherently were created usually by the fears of others, but also by, you know, eventually our own fear. Remember, it's the release of fear that is the problem. We choose to not release fear. So remember, a child who falls over on the ground, you know, if it didn't cry, it would have a fear now of falling. Right? If it's learning to walk and it fell on the ground and hurt itself and it didn't cry, it would now have a fear of falling. But if it releases the pain, it no longer has a fear of falling, and it gets up and tries again. Right?
So does the fear only come from not releasing?
Yeah, the fear comes from, in the case of the child doing that, it might come from the parents laughing at them or ridiculing them or punishing them for falling over, on top of them falling over. And under those circumstances, the child's development would certainly be delayed. Does that make sense? Yeah. And then if the child was told that it can't do it at all, it's never going to be able to do it, and then if you think about it, like if the child was strapped to a bed, that's obviously, most people would never consider doing that. You know, that's one of the worst things you could do. But the reality is, emotionally, that's really what it's like. A lot of the times we're strapped to our parents' definition of what we should do. And so we feel like we can't move beyond that scope. And once you get into that state where, you know, where you're not allowed to even have an experience, then of course lots of fears begin developing, which add to your false beliefs, add to your false definitions of love, and then as that keeps on going, obviously your situation and plight becomes worse and worse and worse. You suppress more emotion, suppress more feelings. And there's people who pass who have had a restrictive life based on their parents, particularly historically, and that's what the magnetic corral is for in the spirit world. You know, that Afra described in those books from Robert James Lee's in the first book, Through the Mist. That's what it's for, removing the restrictions placed on a person that they couldn't get away from. Yeah. But there's personalised restrictions that you place on yourself that you can get away from, and they are the hardest. They are the ones that are not removed for you. You must choose to remove those.
With the magnetic corral, those people that have those restrictions removed, they have that desire and willingness to release that pain, or is...
Well, no, it's the pain, it's the it's the restrictions that have been placed upon their life by others that they could not choose to get away from.
oh, like if I've had a bad childhood, I can choose to get away from that, but not if I've been imprisoned or chained up or something.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's people who have either had emotional or physical restrictions. So for example, a person who has Down syndrome has some very strong physical restrictions placed upon them by their environment that doesn't allow their development. And as a result of that, those particular things that caused that state would be removed. Does that make sense? So it applies a lot to children with who've grown into adults but who have, you know, cognitive difficulties, things like genetic deformations and all those kind of things. They're all removed in that state.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
And then you're left with the choices you made. Now, of course, a person who has cognitive difficulties right from the beginning and, you know, maybe some kind of brain damage at birth or those kind of things, they've not been able to make that many choices, have they, in a cognitive way. So naturally, all of their sin really is attributed to others, to what others have done to them. Does that make sense? It's fair when you think about it. Yeah. So if we go, Joanne.
Would that also include women who've grown up in Eastern countries, or do you consider that when they grow adults they can choose?
It sometimes includes them. It depends on how restrictive their environment has been. But the reality is most people do not, as adults, do not choose to do something different under threat of death. So the reality is you could choose different, even though you might die doing so. And so fear is the main thing that governs their behaviour, and that is a personal choice to allow fear to govern your behaviour. Does that make sense?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, so it depends upon whether other people have governed your choices or whether you've now, you know, you have a degree of confrontation. For example, if every woman in the Eastern, you know, we're in the third world, I suppose we call it nowadays, but, you know, in those areas where women have been oppressed by men for centuries and centuries. And by the way, the Christian faith has repressed women for centuries. So many, many Christian women have also had a lot of repression. Not wanting to get out of that repression, for many of those women, it's for religious reasons they don't want to get out of the oppression. They believe it to be true. And that is a personal choice to believe that. But for those who haven't made a personal choice, then obviously, yes, there are certain things that can be removed. But you've got to be careful here, because there are some restrictions that are placed on a person that are imposed upon them that they have no choice but to accede to them. And they don't have the option of choosing to oppose and die. They don't even have that option. Do you see what I'm saying? Whereas there's other situations where you do have a situation where you could choose to oppose, not to do what you were told to do, and allow whatever happened to happen after that. Right? So we've got to be careful. Many women justify a fear-based choice, and that is a major problem that women have generally, justifying fear-based choices. It's one of the reasons why you think you need a man to make you feel safe and secure, because you're justifying a fear-based choice. So those kind of choices are not included in the magnetic corral. Yeah. Okay, so there's the creation of my pain. Let's have a look at the facade now. Creation of my facade. Two primary decisions are being made in the creation of my facade. What are they? So, Kelly, if we start there.
Being taught not to feel my pain.
Yes. So
to
you
suppress
could,
my emotions.
Yeah, so it's a desire to desensitize. Mm. To my emotion, isn't it? Or we could say emotional pain, or just let's just call it pain. To desensitize to my pain. And the second major reason is, Marion, if we...
Just avoiding the terror.
Yeah, so it's the denial and avoidance of the emotion of terror. There's our primary choices. They're the primary things that trigger our facade. Now, after that, of course, all sorts of things happen as a result of those particular primary choices. Ben?
Is it accurate to say that on the diet, like what you're talking about, the refusal of pain and terror, mm-hmm. and your false beliefs and definitions of love, mm-hmm. is that the source of all your emotional turmoil?
It's not, because in this area here, you create a lot more. So it's not the only source of all of your emotional turmoil, but it's the causal source. The things that happened to you, or that happened, that you chose to do in sin, that cause you to feel turmoil. Whereas these are all, you could say, the emotional effects of the turmoil, all up here.
Kind of, because I was thinking if you healed those things, you still feel pain, but you'll understand everything and you won't feel the...
No, if you heal those things, you won't have pain.
Oh, okay. Mm. All right.
Good, eh?
Yeah.
You heal those things, you won't have pain. The problem is that we're so... Keep asking. The problem is we're so focused on preventing the experience, emotional experience of pain, that we don't finish up healing the pain. To heal pain, you have to actually allow the pain, particularly the emotional pain, to flow. And if we're not allowing it to flow, then of course we can't heal it. Because to heal it, it has to be poured out of us. Now, and only we have control over it getting poured out of us. Nobody else has control of that.
Yeah. I thought about it all day yesterday, and what I came to was that if you healed that, you can still choose to sin again.
You could, but it's highly unlikely. It's less likely you would choose to sin once you've actually had to go through the reversal of all the pain and what it has caused.
Mm.
It's highly unlikely. The first human couple, when they chose to sin, their choice to sin was basically based upon them using their will to reject God. Now, they weren't driven by pain to make that choice. So the reality is we can choose to sin even though we haven't got any pain in us. Certainly that is the case, because that's the development of the will. And that's why we need to see the power of the will. Just because we have pain and just because we have fear, that's not a justification for sinning. Yeah.
Thanks. Yep.
It is a mitigating circumstance, I suppose you could call it, but it's certainly not a justification. Yeah. Okay, so these are our two primary problems. Now, in those primary problems, all of a sudden, bang, a whole heap of things get created, don't they?
Yep.
All right, so when we came to the third talk about the accepting the facade, you can see that the primary focus is going to need to be the removal of the two main things that we do to create the facade. Can you see that? So we need to accept that's what we do. Right? Accept that we're trying to avoid pain all the time. That's our primary motivation. Love isn't our primary motivation, no matter what we tell ourselves. In this place, love isn't our motivation. Avoidance of pain is our motivation. And, of course, you know, trying to get pleasure while avoiding pain is a part of that process. Trying to get pleasure to numb the pain. That's a part of that cycle. And the avoidance of the emotion of terror is another reason why we have created our facade. So to accept our facade, we need to accept that we have a lot of terror within us. And we need to accept that we have a lot of pain within us that we've been trying to avoid the majority of our lives. And that at some point we're going to have to reverse that decision. We need to develop some tools, you know, those four tools of faith, truth, action and emotion. We need to even just develop an aspiration to develop those tools so that we can begin the process of just even accepting this is our state. And part of accepting, did you find that it was easier to accept once you learned how you got it created? It was, wasn't it? So it's easier. You feel a bit softer to it then, don't you? Feel a bit more gentle with yourself in that moment. And that's something that I always try to remember myself. No matter how many people attack me or whatever else, I've just got to always remind myself to be gentle with myself. All right? Because as soon as you get very hard on yourself, now you're avoiding the pain. You're going to be shutting down the pain, so the facade's inevitable. So you really need in this phase here to remind yourself, now there's sort of like a global acceptance of your facade, and then there's like the individual things of, oh, here's a little bit more of my facade that I didn't realize I had before, and you have to accept that as well later down the track. But the global acceptance of your facade is going to be require the awareness of what's going on with these particular decisions you've made. Yeah. So you can see accepting the facade, it's a lot about, you know, no longer denying it, no longer judging it, no longer excusing it, no longer, you know, justifying it or blaming others for it or any of these things. You know, no longer running around busy, trying to deny that it's there and all those kind of things. It means deconstructing quite a number of our pet behaviours, if you like, the ways in which we manage our facade, and just getting to the point where we can sit with it and say, here we go again, here's me trying to think, I'm thinking of doing something, and all this is me just doing something because I'm doing one of these two things. I'm doing something just to avoid some pain or get some pleasure, or I'm doing it so that I can avoid feeling terrified. And once you can sit with that and feel that state, then you're in the process of accepting your facade. This is also where most of your confrontations with the world begins. You see why? Because you're starting to accept what the world denies. So by the time you get to actually deconstructing your facade, which we'll talk about today, you would definitely be generally in some kind of conflict with people in society. And I don't mean that you'll be in conflict with them, they'll be in conflict with you, right? And you'll be in conflict with family members in particular, not your husband and your wife, but rather usually it's your parents and your children, right? Your children, because you created their facade, so anything that you now do to undo your own is going to look opposite to what they want. And your parents, because they created your facade or assisted in its creation, and anything you choose to do is going to oppose their choice to remain where they are. So if you haven't had those kind of conflicts in family, then I suggest to you, you haven't even started dealing with it. Ben?
This relates to that, what you're just kind of talking about, but it's also along the lines of the feedback thing we were speaking. And I realise that love's logical, God's laws are scientific, and truth is black and white.
Yep.
So you could write computer programs, yep, to provide feedback for people.
You could, yeah.
If they were honest in the engagement. Yeah, you could. And at schools, they've got interactive game, play-based,
yes,
tools for English and maths. You could do the same thing for children.
Yes, you could.
But would that create, because you will then be usurping the parent's authority if the child,
you are,
opposes that. So would that be wise, because it might create that situation?
Not without involving the parents, perhaps.
Okay.
You see, Tristan, my son Tristan's working through developing education programs with Eloisa, and they were working first with Eloisa's children, actually, and they're developing an education program that involves educating the parents along with the child.
So that's the answer.
Which is the answer to addressing these particular issues.
Yeah, because just that thing where if you challenge them, you get more punishment, but so you involve the parent in the process.
So all of God's laws are scientific fact, and all of God's laws pertaining to the human soul are also scientific fact, and therefore they're all predictable. So every single disease a person has a predictable emotion associated with that disease, and every single action that you take has a predictable emotion. Any unloving action usually has a predictable emotion associated with that unloving action. And so you could actually program using computerized tools, ways to assist people, you know.
It'd be really intricate. You could really like...
Yeah. You could get very thorough if you wanted to.
And so if you just develop that app or whatever and put it online, you just need to make it locked so the parents somehow engage the parents in that. Otherwise, it's just out there. And
well, I don't see any harm in the children developing it, but the reality is without the parents' involvement, there will be a conflict between the children and the parents. And it's not that you're trying to avoid that, because at the end of the day, that conflict probably has to occur. But it'd be far better if the parents chose, along with the child, to engage the educational program.
Yep.
Okay. Interesting things it all raises, doesn't it? You're like, many of you do not realize the amount of opportunities you have from an employment perspective with regard to understanding God's truth. You know, there's a huge amount of opportunities from an employment perspective as to what you can do to generate a wealth of knowledge and information, but also generate your own livelihoods through the process of sharing these particular truths once you understand them. Yeah. But you've got to obviously first go through the process yourself, isn't it? You know, unless you've gone through the process yourself, it's highly unlikely you'll understand how to develop a computer program that would help others go through a similar process, for example. Yvonne, you would like to say?
Just one question about that. Like, wouldn't there always be terror over our pain?
Well, in the way the human, the way humans are at the moment, yes, that's true. But it doesn't have to be the case. Like a child, you know, when it falls over, doesn't feel terrified of having more pain. It just cries out its current pain and then releases it and then gets up and does exactly the same thing many times. So it's released its pain and therefore there's no terror associated with the same thing occurring again. So terror with regard to pain is all about the rejection of the actual pain itself using techniques, and then this layer of terror is created as a result. So
for us,
yep.
All
of you have terror about pain.
Yes. So for us, our first focus should be the terror.
Well, you know, we'll talk about this today a lot more detail, but obviously. There's two areas of focus, I feel. The reason for the terror is you have a terrible set of emotions about pain, so you need to readjust, to re-educate yourself and readjust your concept of pain. Like, so that's number. That's also a part of dealing with the terror. Terror is an emotion that needs to be released, so you need to get to the point where you're willing to release it. And to get to the point where you're willing to release it requires a number of you to accept a number of truths, but also to be able to sit with an emotion of terror without trying to avoid it. So that requires a sensitization, so a resensitization to emotion generally, and even the emotion of terror, and allowing yourself to experience it without, you know, going into a meltdown about experiencing it. And this is where the majority of us are not willing to go. We think about things and we're trying to do things and so forth to confront terror and so forth, but we're not willing to experience the emotion. It's the emotion, the layers of emotion that we need to release that are causing us to remain stuck. And you remember that God's communication with you is emotional. So while you're in large denial of layers of pretty large emotions, it's going to be very, very hard for you to hear God at all. And in fact, every celestial spirit communicates the same way as God does. So you also will be struggling to hear any celestial spirit. And this is why, you know, I don't believe there's really any person on earth channeling celestial spirits properly at this point, because there's too many people just rejecting their emotions, and it's the way celestial spirits prefer to communicate. So God and celestial spirits communicate using emotion and communicate their concepts and ideas through emotional feelings associated with that process. And it is the most accurate form of communication, but the majority of you can't engage it. And we've explained why it's the most accurate form of communication before, remember? Remember, we've said that a person, you know, we've drawn a diagram for you where a person who's trying to communicate to another person, right, has to first have a feeling that they want to say something. Those feelings are then transmitted into thought. So then comes thought, and that thought needs to be transferred into language that the other person can actually hear. That thought is spoken, you know, with the mouth, and the other person's hearing that. Now the language in this person, this process has to occur where the language has to be transmitted down into the thought and then hopefully generate the same feeling. Right? It's a very complicated method of communication we're engaging. There's three steps on the transmission side and there's three steps on the receiving side. And it's no wonder we often are confused because there's so many areas where accurate communication can go wrong. So I can say words like, I can say, you've sinned. And you can hear that as, you've sinned. You know, one is a pointing out of a fact, the other is the condemnation or a judgment. And you could feel it as a judgment or you could feel it as just a pointing out of a fact, right? But the problem is that this process goes on and God wants to communicate there, you know, straight there. Avoid the language. God doesn't speak in English. Avoid the language, avoid the thoughts, focus on the feeling, the transmission of the feelings. And along comes the inside of the person. Once that is accurate, the thoughts will be accurate. Does that make sense? Yeah, and we've talked about that before many times, actually. I've said that to you. And this is the problem we have, is that we're constantly trying to understand and communicate using different methodologies and as a result, getting quite confused in the process. So frequently you think I'm saying something I'm not saying at all, even though, like, I understand my words may be interpreted that way, but if you could feel my feelings about it, you would know that you were wrong in your understanding of it. Does that make sense? And this is why it's good for you to engage questions, because in the process of questions, I can elucidate further and hopefully eventually get the feeling transmitted. Right, so every time I've talked to you about sin in the past, you've always felt condemned, right? So why is that? I don't feel condemnatory of a person who sins, not as God actually. So why do you feel that way? Well, that's because of your own feelings about the word and your own feelings about what it connotates inside of you and your own judgment, and your own denial of it and so forth. And it's very hard for me to undo all of that without going through this process of explaining how you work, you know, what's going on inside of you, why it happens. So this is where what we're trying to do here is separate, remember, your worth, you know, how you think you're getting valued from the facts. You know, God's whole universe is all about facts. Even the way God made you is all about facts. There's a beautiful truths, you know, facts. About how you've been created, and if you understand them better, then you understand yourself better. But you can see that this way of communicating, in the end, it's ineffectual. That's why there's so much confusion, but also misunderstanding on the planet. You know, you start trying to communicate something to your partner, and before you know it, she's interpreted completely opposite of what you thought, but what you were thinking at the time. And frequently, that's because we have so many areas where even our own feeling doesn't properly get transmitted to our own thoughts due to emotional blockages that we have here and there. It doesn't get properly said, you know, and then it doesn't get properly transferred into language, you know, and for the majority of us, I know for me, like, my understanding of the English language is probably like 20% of what the vocabulary of the English language is, or if that, right? And and that's the only language I can speak. Pretty bad, isn't it? Mary can speak three languages, but you know, the same sort of applies, where our understanding of each language is generally affected by this process, you know. And then on the reception side, of course, transmitting a language into a thought, into a feeling is quite complicated. You've got all these different things going on inside of yourself that's going to determine how you feel about what's being said to you. Yeah, and so it's very hard for us then to accept facts. And God wants to tell us facts. Yeah? You get that? Everything's a fact. All of God's truths are facts. They're scientific facts. Yeah, predictable. The universe is beautiful. It's predictable. The way, what happens to your body? Predictable. Your illnesses, all predictable. Isn't it wonderful? It means that if you find its original cause, you can remove it in all the people who have it. Right? It's not indiscriminate like we believe. You know, most of us believe that God's somehow indiscriminate and all of God's laws are indiscriminate and we don't know why one person dies and one person lives and all those things. Well, all those things from God's perspective are predictable. Great, eh? Means that we can work through the issues. So let's get to our homework. We've only got 20 minutes or so to deal with it. So let's look at the questions that you had. The first question was, what lies do I tell myself about myself? Now remember, these were what you would classify, what many of you are thinking of, positive lies, but also negative lies, you know what I mean, which we discussed when we asked the question. So what lies do I tell myself about myself? What did you learn in that little exercise? Alan, thanks. And on this side was Cavill. Did you have your hand up? Yep.
Last night I'd realised that I'm always telling myself that I'm always losing weight.
Yeah.
Which is really, that's not what's happening.
Isn't it? You're getting heavier instead. Yeah. No worries. Just a physical lie, yep. So often we don't like what we see in a mirror, so we've got to tell ourselves all sorts of things to mitigate that, don't we? Cable?
I tell myself that I'm honest and sincere, and I've certainly uncovered lots of errors within me that are anything but honest and sincere.
Good, eh? So we tell ourselves that we're honest and truthful, those kind of things. If we go to Deidre.
Oh, no, I got the mic.
You got the mic, so it's easy. And on this side, if we go to Eloisa.
I learned that if I'm in a facade, I can be in a facade trying to tell, you know, see what lies I tell myself, and that can be all false. And luckily I was encouraged yesterday, thanks to someone, to just dig a little deeper, and I got attacked a little bit, so I'm like, oh, I'm on the right track. But it's so easy to just be in a facade to...
Yeah, so your facade wants to tell you your lies. Because it feels that that's the support of your pain. So your facade wants to create lies. And, you know, it's like, tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. And that's how we see everything too. We see them as sweet. We see them as good for us. We see them as, and in the end, unfortunately, we believe them. We believe them. And like I've said to you before, believing them is one of the worst things you can do. Yeah. Eloisa?
Yes, I have said to me many times that I have progressed after learning divine truth a bit.
Yeah. If you just hold that mic a bit closer.
Yeah, and I was lying to me about my progression.
Right, yeah.
Just realizing that I even started.
Yeah, probably. How many of you have been doing that? You've been listening to Divine Truth for a while and you tell yourself, yeah, I'm going all right, I'm progressing, I'm getting along there, I'm progressing. And then when you look at some of the material that gets presented, you go, maybe I'm not progressing. When you progress, change happens quite rapidly in your life. And remember what I just said earlier too, when you progress, you will find that conflict with all the people who are not progressing will automatically come your way. And most of you are trying to avoid that. So that's telling you that you're not progressing. If you're trying to avoid the conflict, you're not going to progress. Simple as that. All right, let's go to the next question. I'll just grab my notes here. What lies do I tell myself about fear and pain itself or themselves? About the emotion of fear and the pain I feel. So Liam, if we come to Liam and then down to Louise.
What pain?
Exactly, yeah. Oh, I'm not in pain. They tell me I'm in pain. Yeah, total denial. Total denial. Very good. Louise?
Being and remaining a victim is a natural consequence of my difficult childhood.
Yep, so you're basically telling yourself that...
It's okay.
It's okay because these bad things happened.
Yeah, and it was bad.
It was bad and there's not much I can do about it now.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's just bad and that's the way it is. If we come across site to... Can't see your name, probably Janine, that's right. Sorry, Janine.
Pain will hurt me.
Yeah, well, I suppose the word pain indicates that. but yeah, isn't there a feeling, not just that it'll hurt you, but you're not going to be able to cope with it?
I wrote that too.
Yeah, yeah. So you're not going to cope with it. It's going to be so bad that it's just going to get so overwhelming that you're just probably going to go nuts or something. You know, most people have that. Yeah, it's a global fear most people have. We've passed it down to Barb. If we go across to Judith on this side, thanks, Judith first. Sorry, guys. Sorry for the... Just wait for the cameras to catch up with you.
I just...
thanks, Judith.
Okay, if I get into a hot and heavy romantic relationship, I won't have any pain.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, if I get my addictions met, I'll be right. Yeah. If I could just have that ice cream, or if I just can eat that particular food, or take that particular drug, or get this emotional thing fixed, or have a house in the near the beach, or whatever it is that you feel will sort of mitigate the pain, let's feed the addiction. Go ahead and feed the addiction. That gets rid of the pain. Unfortunately, as many of you now know, it doesn't. Does it? It just leaves it there. And eventually the pain, even in those locations, catches up to you. So you get into the relationship and you think it's great at the beginning and off you go. You're feeding your addictions in this frenzy, and then all of a sudden it all starts turning bad on you. And you feel like it's going out of control now, you know. And it is, of course, which it has to do because God's trying to destroy it. Can you get that? God wants to destroy any relationship based upon addiction. Have you ever thought of that? Never thought of that. Well, all of God's laws have been constructed to destroy any relationship based on addiction. That's God's laws. Like, whole God's universe has been created to destroy any relationship based on addiction. So you enter a relationship based on addiction. What's God's intention? It's going to destroy it. Good luck with trying it. Good luck with having a successful relationship based on the addiction. Does that make sense? We need to see it this way, you see. This is how I see things. And so this is how God sees things too. Like, God's universal laws have been constructed to bring everything in the universe into harmony with those laws. So if your relationship is out of harmony with those laws, then what's God trying to do? God's trying to destroy it. So, this whole concept of I'm going to stay in my marriage, keep getting these addictions met, right, without addressing the addictions between myself and my partner, and I'm staying in a marriage, well, good luck with that, because God's laws are trying to destroy that marriage. Interesting, isn't it? Yeah. Same goes with relationships with children, same goes with relationships with parents. Most of those are full of addiction because our parents usually created the addictions in the child or had a large, substantial desire to create the addictions in the child. So of course, a lot of those relationships have to get reconstructed. They have to be firstly destroyed and then reconstructed in a different way. That's what has to happen if those relationships are ever going to continue. Yeah, interesting. Okay, well, let's move on to the next, I think, because we're running out of time here. How do I believe that my facade protects me from fear and pain? So, did you find that was a good question too? So if we come, sorry, Barb, you were last time, but let's discuss this particular issue on Barb, and let's go across to Nina. Was Nina, you with the hand up? Yeah, thanks, on this side. Barb first.
On this one, my facade tells me to just forge forward, keep going, and you'll get through it.
Something will get better sometime.
Of course. And a good night's sleep is going to help everything.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. A bit of a visit to the sleep state, as always. You know, sleeping, though, is like that a bit, isn't it? It is a welcome relief sometimes from life.
It's a gift, actually.
It is a gift.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is a gift, but it depends whether we're using it to, you know, just remain zoned out, tuned out or not, isn't it? Yeah. So that's why many of us don't want to wake up in the mornings when it gets light. So we sleep in, and we sleep in until 2 hours after it's light. Right? And this is why also why many of us don't want to go to bed at night. So, you know, why does it get dark now, about 6 or something like that? And most of us go to bed when? 2, really? I don't know how you manage that. Yeah, without a fail, I'm usually in bed by 8, you know, like, and I wake up as soon as, or just before light, usually, just like, yeah. And that's what will happen when you, you know, so in a way, you don't really need lights in your house. Interesting, isn't it? Because if you're more in tune with the way God's designed the universe, you'd probably just go to sleep when it's dark and wake up when it's light. And we don't do that because of all sorts of addictions and facade, and we want entertainment, we're scared of going to sleep, we're scared of passing through the labyrinth of spirits that surround us while we're off into the sleep state, and then we're scared of coming back as well for all sorts of reasons. Yeah, there's all sorts of sort of things there as well. We were over at Nina, thank you.
I found that this one was useful for exposing the lies as well.
Yeah.
So basically my facade helps me be accepted, and then I just don't get attacked.
Yeah, yeah. So there you go. What I find about this particular question, it helps you identify your fears better, helps you identify where your pain is as well. So, for example, when we get attacked, how do we feel about ourselves? So there's the pain. And when we get attacked, how afraid are we? And there's the fear. So it's like, you can identify the two main things in each case just by letting yourself reflect upon how you believe the facade protects you from those things. Yeah. Fourth, what are my personal techniques for presenting the emotion of fear? So, Karen, if we want to start there and then come down to Talia on this side, thanks.
I realise that I run away. I run away physically, I run away in my thoughts, and yeah. I run away from my emotions.
Okay, so...
nice and easy.
So, yeah, and what techniques do you use to run? Like, do you just leave the situation, or do you busy yourself doing something else? What's your primary?
Well, that's physically, since I was very little, I go out somewhere where there's nobody else.
Right, so you go out in nature and call it, I'm enjoying nature.
Yeah, but it's to get away from people.
Yeah, I've done that all my life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the thoughts, like, they just go on and on and on. And it's because I don't want to think about what I should be thinking about.
Yeah. When I was a child, I used to go out riding. I used to live in a small town down in the riverland of in South Australia. And it was surrounded by mallee as well as, you know, vines and, you know, orchards and stuff. And I used to get on my bike, and I did this as soon as I got a bike, and I got a bike when I was 4 years old. And so by the time I was 5, I was out riding my bike along these roads and in this place looking at, you know, birds, basically. I used to do a lot of bird watching. But that was my excuse to get away from people. That's how I got away from people. And I used to do it all day for days and days and days, and then my parents didn't know where I was, usually from 8 or 9 in the morning to 4 or 5 at night. I used to take a little backpack with me and pack my lunch and everything. Just to stay away.
Works
from...
so well.
Yeah. So, you know, a lot of our love of nature. You got to question whether it's really a love of nature or just a love to get away from people. Yeah. We were at Thalia next.
Yeah, I've tried a few tactics. Mostly anger throughout all my life has been a massive tactic to get away from fear.
All right, so projecting anger at others?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Revenge, retaliation.
Yeah.
Anything I can concoct up in my mind about what I can do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's been a big one.
Yeah.
You know, lately it's numbing out.
Yeah.
Just anything I can do to distract myself.
So you've swapped the anger for numbing out.
Yeah. You know, zoning out.
And, yeah. Yeah.
You know, getting like entrenched in, you know, what I think is my passion or my gift and, you know, just completely being the one to stay up at 2 or 3 in the morning.
Yeah.
You know, just escape.
Yeah. Yeah. Escaping is a big thing, isn't it? Trying to escape. Well, it's funny, once we remove one or two different types of addictions from the facade, there's usually a whole new generation of some more addictions, you know, that replace those ones. They weren't as effective as those ones, so we still feel a bit sad about them, but they're effective enough to stop us from feeling pain. And so we've just got to be very careful that we just don't swap one addiction for another. Yeah. Which is also like swapping one person for another.
Yeah.
You know, with our partnership, for example, you know, just not being happy in a relationship, this relationship, and instead of working through the issues of this relationship, working through what it is that causes us to not be happy, because at some point we were happy, so we've got to look at what caused us to be happy and what caused us to be unhappy. Instead of doing that as much as we can together, what we do, we just go, I'm not happy with you anymore, and on to another person. Right, and that's the same thing. It's just swapping one person for another. We swap one job for another, one person for another, one passion for another. We call them passions, you know. But we swap one for another. As soon as one gets challenging, oh, that's not feeding my addiction anymore, so get rid of that one and get a new one. Sometimes we do a whole heap of things like not finishing things, because we get the addiction met only when we start things. So we get the addiction met when we start things, but as it goes on, all of God's laws show us where the correction needs to be, and what happens is we don't like that. So we go, oh, things are not working with this now, and I don't really like it now because I'm getting challenged in all these areas, so I'll throw away that. That mustn't have been my passion. And then I go on to another one. I select another one. And eventually you run out of them. And that's why when you get old, you get grumpy. Because you run out of all these different options that you had before when you were young. Because you know, you've tried each one of them and each one of them didn't work properly, and you weren't willing to address the unloving beliefs and unloving emotions, and as a result you couldn't purify it, you couldn't purify the design, so you just get triggered every time, and so you just leave that one and go on to another one, and leave that one and go on to another one, and your whole life becomes like a procession of passions that you thought you had that you found out you didn't have at all, because they didn't meet your addictions anymore after you engaged them a short period of time. Yeah. And then by the time you're 70 or 80, you're left with reading books and watching telly. And if you're, you know, the average person in that age, you know, you find it really hard to move. You find it really hard to enjoy your life in any other way. So that's what you engage. And then you die. And then you haven't got reading books and watching telly. And so what do? You come back to earth and find somebody who does read books and watch telly, and you do it with them. You know, it just depends on how long you want to do this, right? You can do this for thousands of years. All right, so the fifth one was, what do I feel like doing when I confront the truth about myself? Now, this was a very important question. And what did you find you did? If we go to Dave, and then straight back to Teresa.
Yeah, I don't want to, and I just ignore it.
When you say you don't want to,
what
do you feel, Dave? So you don't want to is not a feeling.
I suppose some of the feelings are like I'm scared and judge myself and be hard on myself and...
See, now you're just guessing. I think you need to sit more with that question.
Yep.
Because you need to remind yourself that you need to stop being general with a lot of your answers to yourself even. You need to be really specific. Being specific is good for you. So my suggestion is, what is it when somebody tells you the truth, what do you feel inside of you? Now, I know some feelings you have that I've felt from you when I've told you some truths. Things like you felt disapproved.
Yep.
You felt like I didn't approve of you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you walk away sort of all dejected because you feel like somebody doesn't approve of you.
And judged so, and...
Yeah, so you need to be more specific with the feelings because these feelings will help you identify what you're afraid of and what where the pain is. You follow?
Yep.
So if we can go back straight back to through Dieter's trees.
I want to avoid feeling shame or bad or stupid or worthless.
Yeah, so shame and stupid, feeling shame and stupid. So this tells you some hurts, doesn't it, from your childhood? Shamed, being shamed. Being shamed is a main way that parents control their children. And feeling stupid, you know, and another main way that parents control their children, telling them that they're stupid when the child hasn't even had the opportunity to learn what the right thing to do or what the parent thinks is the right thing to do frequently. So these are feelings. Whenever we think about being told the truth, the feelings that we feel under those circumstances will help us identify the pains we have associated with truth. And that's very powerful, to know the pain that we have about hearing truth. Very powerful. If we come across to Pamela on this side.
When you've told me the truth in the past, I just go blank and can't think. And I can't feel. That's because I normally try to think my emotions and I suddenly feel, oh my God, I'm wrong. How can I fix this? How can I adjust my thinking to feel the right feeling?
Yeah, so this is about making mistakes, isn't it?
Yes.
Is this emotion? It's about feeling that it's okay to not be right. It's okay to not know. It's okay to not be aware and it's okay to make a mistake. And so obviously from your childhood you weren't allowed to make mistakes, otherwise you wouldn't have that emotion. You follow?
Yep, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, but it is a major, I notice that a lot when I speak with different people where I say some truth to them and it's like they just go, they're gone. They're like, where are they now? They've disappeared. They've gone. They're not present anymore. And from that moment on it's pointless me saying anything actually. Because nothing I say is going to get through that barrier of, I didn't want to hear that and I'm not going to hear that and that's it. And the key is to find out why that barrier is established internally, what's going on that causes that barrier to come up. That is another emotion that's going to, if you get rid of it, you'll be able to absorb truth. And absorbing truth is key to your progress. Mm. So being able to absorb truth is a very, very important part of progression. Anyway, we need to move on. So you can see that we could have a long discussion, couldn't we, about those five questions. We could probably go on for days and days and days discussing those five questions, actually. So you can see that we have very many motivations for rejecting our facade rather than accepting it. And the key... The key to understanding yourself is firstly to understand not only how your pain was created and not only how your facade was created, but also get to the point where you actually accept that that's happened to you. Right? That you actually accept that pain has been created, that facade has been created, and that you can get to the point where you accept this facade, you accept this is how it is. Basically, it means accepting the truth of where you're at right now. And unless you accept the truth of where you're at right now, you have no hope to have an awakening to sin. You have no hope to have an awakening. And therefore, if no awakening occurs, none of God's love can flow. And this is why many of us haven't experienced the reception of God's love, because God's trying to trigger us into awakening. You know, your guides are good guys, you know, and good girls, I suppose, if we should use both genders. But they're leading you to truth all the time. All of God's laws are constructed leading you to truth all the time. And unless you have this awakening that this is the truth of where I'm at, no further progression can be made. So they know that. They've been through that themselves. Any celestial spirit has had to go through this process. So they've all been through it. They all know what you need to do. and are trying to assist you to do it. That's why you get dragged along to Jesus events, even when sometimes you don't want to come, right? It's not me that drags you along. Someone's going, yeah, I think you need to go. I think it'd be good for you, I think. And you go, oh, I suppose. I suppose I'll do that. I'm just going to hear a whole heap of negative things about myself again. And they're just saying, no, you need to have this acceptance of this facade, no judgment, acceptance of where you're at first before you can grow, before you can change. It's great, eh? Anyway, we must move on, Karina. So, all right, well, let's have a 10-minute break, which means 20, if we can come 20 to 12. Is that right? Yep, 20 to 12. And we'll get started on our program today.